No Other Love, Joe Stafford singing. So you knew the song from your father?
That one, not from my dad, but that, you know, that one, I don't know where I came up with that one initially, but that's, and there's a kind of, the piano chords are actually just a Chopin piece that somebody put lyrics to, basically, and I don't know where I came up with this one. A couple of years ago, I found it, about 7 or 8 years ago, I first heard this, but Joe Stafford is just the greatest that there is, and to my mind, she's probably my favorite singer of that period.
It's a long list, but
she's at the top.
Do you know her stuff, her comedy stuff?
I sure do. Yeah. With Paul Weston.
With Paul Weston. Right? Yeah, absolutely.
That's right. Yeah, I do.
I forget the character's name.
It'll
Jonathan
come to
and
me.
Darlene it, Edwards.
Jonathan and Darlene. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that stuff is great to me, and, you know, kind of in that same, I mean, it's not as outlandish as Spike Jonze stuff, but
I
love that stuff too, but you know, it's more low key, but oh yeah, she's the greatest.
So let's play Joe Stafford's recording of No Other Love, which you use in the movie. But you were saying you knew you wanted to use this at some point, and you were just waiting. Is that, did I get the right impression?
Yeah, definitely. This is one that you don't let get away, you know. And we had a few different songs that I would listen to while I was writing the movie or getting it together or filming it. And you're never exactly sure which one might work or not, you know. And this one just rose to the top for sure as a kind of the way that it moved, the way that it felt, and, you know, obvious sort of connotations in the lyrics, how it could fit the relationship of these two men and how they feel about each other. Also just really nice to have a woman's voice come in, like as a nice feeling to the film after these, it's so kind of boy heavy between the two of them, you know. It's really nice having this sort of angel voice come in over the film.
So this is Joe Stafford, No Other Love, and it's on the soundtrack of Paul Thomas Anderson's new movie, The Master.
No other love can warm my heart now that I've known.
That's Joe Stafford singing No Other Love, and it's used on the soundtrack of the new movie, The Master. My guest is the writer and director of the film, Paul Thomas Anderson, who also made Boogie Nights, Magnolia, and There Will Be Blood. So you mentioned that you knew a lot of music from this period from your father. Did he fight in World War II?
He was there. He was in the Navy, stationed mainly in Guam. I don't think he did any fighting. I think he was fixing airplanes and knew just where the beer was stashed and playing saxophone in bands and stuff like that. You know, every picture I have of him, he's got a beer in his hand. every single picture from the war he's got. So he was pretty good about probably finding ways to get out of fighting. But again, we never really talked that much about it.
So there weren't images that you used in the movie that were based on experiences that he shared with you?
No, not that he shared with me. Some of the photographs of him on a beach, he sort of stuck in my mind's eye. You know, one of the stories in the film, it comes from Jason Robards, who famously fought in the war, was in the Navy.
And he starred in your movie Magnolia.
That's right. And I worked with him in Magnolia, and he told me the story of coming back. I don't remember what boat he was on, but he was coming back, and VJ Day was announced, and they'd run out of booze. And they broke into the torpedoes and drank the booze out of there And the way he tells it is he woke up the next morning on the mast of the ship, you know, and an inch either way he would have fallen to his death. And that story just stuck with me as a great story and something to get into a film.
It's a very disorienting image when you see Joaquin Phoenix on the top of the mast. It's just a really odd angle. So he drank booze from the torpedoes? I don't...
Well, it's ethanol, I think, that helps propel the torpedoes and make it move, you know. Yeah,
there's some raunchy paint thinner kind of rat gut in your film.
I think the idea with ethanol is that if you put just a few drops and then squeeze as many coconuts or papaya, whatever you've taken back with you from the island, you sort of 99% juice and maybe 1% ethanol, you'll get a pretty good buzz.
The Master is shot in 65mm film, and I don't know enough about film stock to understand what that actually means, so I'm going to ask you to explain it.
Oh, God, neither do I. It's bigger, you know, that's really all that it is. That's most film stock is 35mm. This is 65mm, so it's a larger format, a larger negative. It was something that was invented. I don't actually remember exactly when it was invented. I think actually some of these 65mm formats go back actually to the 20s and 30s, but it became very popular in the middle 50s. People were using it to create these 70mm sort of large-scale presentations. West Side Story was done that way, and some of these larger epics. Probably another way to compete with television. But the negative is very, very big and very rich, and you get a really kind of wonderful quality about it.
What could you do with that you would have not done as well with 35mm?
It's a different film, so it's a different feeling. It's really that simple. But, you know, ultimately, you are a little bit, you know, with the 35mm camera, they're small. I mean, you can be as small as a little speaker that I'm looking at here, you know, sort of no bigger than a laptop. Some of these cameras are teeny, you know, and with 65mm cameras, you are limited because they're incredibly large, and they're loud, and you can't kind of fling them around or put them on a Steadicam, you can put them on your shoulder if you have a really good chiropractor, masseuse, so they're limiting in that way, but that's kind of was good for us, you know. We were trying to be kind of straightforward and simple, old-fashioned, so yeah, like that, and they're loud. They're very loud. You hate them. You can hear.
So, are there movies that you looked at, or illustrations that you looked at, to immerse yourself in what the period looked like and in what 1950 looked like?
Well, yeah. I mean, we got into the 65mm business just because you'd see. Like North by Northwest or Vertigo had those kind of wonderful colors, those are designed films of that period. You know, is that an exact, accurate representation of what 1952 really looked like? I don't know. Maybe it is. I mean, you can find color photographs from that era, and hopefully they're kind of snapshots or portrait photos. Those are the kinds of things that we looked at. You know, those kinds of things that you go into a department store and get your picture taken, you know, in your wedding gown or with your family, and you're all dressed up in the same kind of outfits and stuff like that. Those somehow were the most kind of candid and revealing and helped you, you know, time travel, sort of look at these faces, look at that period, look at that era, and try and kind of imagine not just what was happening when the picture was taken, but what would happen right after the picture was taken.
Well, you know, the Joaquin Phoenix character is a photographer in a department store briefly and takes the kind of photographs that you're describing. And I felt like I knew all those photographs.
Right.
There's the one, everyone will recognize this, it's like the three brothers in size place, like the three young boys in size place order in a horizontal line, like sitting in a horizontal line with that kind of smeary colored backdrop behind them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
Yeah, it's all about the backdrop, I have to say. There's a yellow backdrop that just sort of, you know, does all the work for you, and you just get a really large light and you aim it directly at the subject. We were taking real photographs and just kind of trying to emulate them, and I have to say, you know, I'm very, very proud of those. It was sort of a combination of things really coming together, with the costumes being right and the haircuts right, and the faces of these those boys and other people there. And you know, they don't make faces like they used to. It's funny. You know, you have to search them out. You have to find them. I wanted to put my own kids in there, but I couldn't. You know, my kids don't look like they lived in 1950.
Now, we've talked about this a little bit before, but your late father, Ernie Anderson, was a horror movie host. He was the character Goulardi, who would introduce horror films on television, and he was also the ABC announcer who used to do the coming-ups for all the shows, so it would be, why don't you say it? You'll do it better than me.
You know, it'd be like, this week, Balky gets a headache on Perfect Strangers, you know, that kind of thing, you know, or The Love Boat.
Yeah, do The Love Boat.
The Love Boat.
Yeah.
I can't do it well. My brother can do it really well. My brother has a voice like my dad. You know, Mork and Mindy, all these like TV shows from the mid-70s. Vegas was the other one. Remember that Robert Urich show, Vegas?
Mm-hmm.
They used to have this thing about my dad, somebody, this joke, they say, what's it like when you go to breakfast? Does he say, I'll have two eggs, hash browns, and toast? And, somewhere out there, there's a great blooper reel of my dad, you know, sitting at this mic reminds me of sort of growing up, too, because I would go with him to ABC, and I just loved it. Loved, you know, watching people work the gear and work with him and record these things. And you know, it was a step towards what I wanted to do, sort of being in that world. I mean, just sort of being around technicians and moving parts and machines and things like that, and microphones and, you know, video rolling. And I just loved it. Amazing, amazing. Brings back memories sitting in front of a microphone like this.
Because your father showed horror movies on TV, did you grow up with a lot of horror films?
Not really, no. We didn't watch them at home or anything like that. I think he did that gig, and that was what it was. His preference for films were more Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers, things like Preston Sturges, His Girl Friday, and anything, absolutely anything, with Spencer Tracy. Captain Courageous, that was another one of his favorite films. So he had tastes more like that than kind of B-horror stuff.
So he should have been on Turner Classic Movies.
Absolutely. You know, Turner Classics used to be AMC. I think it was, you know, AMC, and we would watch that together. And now to this day, that's kind of my biggest source of inspiration. I've talked about it, you know, just having Turner Classics on around all the time as a kind of like Muzak in your house it's great. You can, you know, the ability to see all this stuff and that you'd never be able to find or dig through if it wasn't for Turner Classic Movies. God, long may they wave. I hope they never go away.
Yeah, me too. Me too. Visually, the Master has a lot of very, like, saturated color. Like, a lot of the men are wearing blue suits, and it's not just, like, blue. It's, like, blue. This is, like, a really saturated blue that really, it's beautiful, but it really kind of, like, pops from the screen. And there are, like, golden yellow colors that are just, like, so rich. And a pair of red pajamas that he's wearing that are so very red. So when you're looking for that kind of super saturated color, is that a question of just like getting the right fabric? Or is that something special that's happening with the lighting, with the film stock?
I think all of the above, really. I think the first thing you ask yourself is, are we really going to do these red pajamas? You know, would this character wear these red pajamas? And then if the answer is yes, you